Tantor Audio presents The Stolen Crown by Susan Higginbotham. Narrated by John Lee and Alison Larkin. Now take heed what love may do, for love will not, nor may not, cast no fault nor peril in nothing. Gregory's Chronicle on the Marriage of Edward IV and Elizabeth Woodville. 1. Harry, November 1st, 1483. You might think that the last night of a condemned traitor would be a rather solitary affair, but you would think wrong, for the last couple of hours have been bustling with people coming and going. In some ways I welcome the commotion. It keeps my mind from the object that lies hard by my lodgings here at the Blue Boar Inn in Salisbury. It is a scaffold, and I will be its first, and probably its last occupant, for it has been built just for me. Such is the fate of a man who tries to take a king from his throne and fails. Yet I do wish that things were more peaceful so I could better gather my thoughts, for what I say in the next world about my life will determine whether I am saved or damned. The best way to explain myself, I suppose, is to start at the beginning. People who knew all of us say, or said, for there are few of them alive now, that I favour my mother more than my father. I will have to take their word for it, for he died just a month or so after I turned 3. I remember a man who bounced me on his shoulders and held me on his lap when I saw him, which was not all that often, and I remember the scar on his right hand, which I would trace wonderingly because it made the hand so different from my mother's, soft and white, and my nurse's, plump and scarred by nothing worse than years of honest labour. Father's scar was from the Battle of St. Albans in May 1455. The battle had been a disastrous one for my family. My mother's father, Edmund Beaufort, Duke of Somerset, had died there, and his eldest son, Henry, had been hauled away insensible in a cart, more dead than alive. My paternal grandfather, Humphrey, had had his face slashed, and my father, too, had been badly injured. Worse, the battle had left the Duke of York the ruler of England in all but name, and my family had fought for the House of Lancaster. All of this must have dispirited my parents, and I like to think I cheered them a little when I was born, on the 4th day of September of that year, and when I was named not Humphrey, the name my father and his father bore, but Henry, after the king for whom they had fought. I do hope, indeed, I cheered them, for in my 28 years in this world I do not think I can say that I have done so for many people. In the fall of 1458, the pestilence, which in those days still swept through England regularly, paid one of its dreaded visits. It did what the Yorkists had failed to do, kill my father. As I was now the heir to the dukedom of my grandfather, he and my grandmother wished to take custody of me. So to their care I went, once the pestilence had stopped its raging and it was considered safe for me to travel. I was not much upset at the change. The two mainstays of my existence at that time were my nurse and my puppy, and both went with me. I came to know my grandfather somewhat better than I had my father, being more of an age now to observe what went on around me, and being doted on by my grandparents besides that. 4 of their 7 sons had died young. My father had just died, and neither of my surviving uncles, Henry and John, had sons yet. I, therefore, was precious. Grandfather, Humphrey Stafford, was a good man who tried to do what was best for England and to protect King Henry while trying to reach some sort of accord with the Duke of York. If only he had lived longer for me to profit by his example. As I settled into my new life with my grandparents, fortune's wheel, which had been spinning back and forth with regularity, spun in the direction of Lancaster. As a result, not long before the Christmas of 1459, visitors arrived at my grandparents' Essex manor of Rittle, Cecily Neville, Duchess of York, and her 3 youngest children, Margaret, George, and Richard. Cecily was my grandmother's younger sister. Needless to say, she and my Lancastrian grandmother had not been on the warmest of terms as of late, and though we politely referred to her and her children as our guests, it was no social visit the Duchess of York was paying now. The Duke of York was in exile, and his wife had been placed in my grandmother's custody at the order of King Henry. Since the youngest of the York children, Richard, has proven to be the death of me, I wish I could say there was a sense of doom from the first day of our meeting back at Riddle, but of course there wasn't. I was 4 at the time, just a month shy of being 3 years younger than Richard and nearly 6 years younger than George. My younger brother, Humphrey, who had been born shortly before my father died, was living with my mother. Thus, up until now, there had been no other boys in the household except for pages, whose duties kept them to themselves. Naturally, I was delighted by this new company. I tagged along behind the York brothers, did my best to insinuate myself into their games, and tried with all my might to impress them. I am sure they regarded me as a thoroughgoing nuisance, and a Lancastrian nuisance at that. Probably I was an annoyance in another way as well. At the time, neither Richard nor George was a duke or a king's brother. They were simply two younger sons, far less important in the grand scheme of things than their father or their two older brothers, Edward and Edmund, both of whom were earls. Even at my young age, I, on the other hand, knew full well that I would be the next Duke of Buckingham, heir to one of the richest estates in the realm. I probably pointed this out more often than was strictly necessary. Yes, I must have been completely insufferable. Grandmother counted Queen Margaret among her dear friends, and often said that the Queen was only doing what was right, fighting for her husband's throne and that of her dear little son, Edward. She could not forbear from expressing this opinion to Cecily, who, as Duchess of York, held a view that was considerably to the contrary. Because of this, there was occasional tension in the household, but for the most part the sisters rubbed along well enough. Both, after all, were worried for their husbands and sons, and both knew that their lives could be changed at a stroke of a battle axe. For about 7 months we lived together in this fashion. Then one day, in July 1460, I was confined indoors with a bad cold, much to my disgust, for it was the first day in several that it had not rained. George and Richard were outdoors shooting at butts, and I deluded myself that I had improved my skill enough to give them at least a hint of competition. Some men came to see Grandmother on business, and she left the solar where the rest of us had gathered and was gone a while. I was tossing a ball to my dog, and Cecily and her daughter Margaret were at their embroidery, when Richard and George rushed into the room as Cecily was critiquing Margaret's stitches. "Mother, do you know what has happened?"
"Obviously not. George, when will you learn not to interrupt?"
"It is important, Mother, truly. We heard it from the servants of the men who came here just now. Mad King Henry has been taken captive by the Earl of Warwick and Ned."
"It was at a place called Northampton," put in Richard.
"It's a disaster for Lancaster, Mother. The men who were guarding that fool Henry's tent were killed by the Kentish men. They didn't stand a chance. The Earl of Shrewsbury, Egremont, the Viscount Beaumont, and best of all, the Duke of Buckingham. Dead, all of them, the rats."
"George, you fool."
Margaret dropped her embroidery.
"Harry?" "Oh."
George winced and looked at me.
Sorry.
"It's a lie," I said. "You're just making that up to tease me."
He often did things like that, and having grown up with no other children in the household until recently, I was particularly vulnerable to such tactics. Hopefully I looked around for confirmation of my words. Richard shook his head.
"No, Harry, it's the truth."
I broke free of Margaret's consoling hand and ran to my grandmother's chamber. She was sitting in her cushioned window seat, sobbing. I had not known until then that people of my grandmother's age, she was nigh on 50, cried. I had no need to ask her if what I had heard was true. When she saw me, she wrapped her arms around me and held me tight, but she did not stop weeping until my own sobs started.
"Get your tears out now, Harry,"
Grandmother said, patting me on the back as I huddled against her shoulder.
"Don't let that Yorkist brood of Cecily's see you cry. And then when you are done, I have something for you."
After a time, she rang a bell and whispered something into the ear of the page, who responded. When he came back, he bore a small box. Grandmother unlatched the box and showed me the coronet glittering inside it.
"Wear it proudly, my boy, in your grandfather's memory," she said,
setting the golden coronet on my curling black hair as I brushed at my eyes.
"You are now the second Duke of Buckingham."
2. Kate, September 1464. It was on a fine September morning in 1464 that the king married my sister, although I couldn't tell a soul about it, and in truth I wasn't supposed to know myself. I found out the secret when, just after dawn, my older sister kicked me in her sleep. As Joan was a compulsive kicker and I was well used to such awakenings, I normally would have gone back to sleep, but something made me sit up instead and listen. There appeared to be more life in our manor house at Grafton than usual, a sense of something extra going on besides the usual servants arising. Disentangling my legs from my sister's, not only did she kick me, she encroached upon my half of the bed, though she claimed it was purely accidental. I climbed out of bed, took my nightrobe off its peg, draped it over my shoulders, tucked my favourite doll under my arm for company, and quietly made my way downstairs. Sure enough, there were sounds coming from the chapel, a highly unusual occurrence, for these days my family was in no position to keep its own chaplain. I pulled upon the heavy door. Inside were a priest, my mother, two gentlewomen of my mother's acquaintance, a good-natured-looking man whom I guessed to be in his early 30s, my sister Elizabeth, and a rather young man, the last two kneeling by the altar. It was obvious even to my six-year-old self that I had interrupted a wedding, but why on earth was my sister getting married at dawn, with none of the family present but mother? And why was everyone, even the bride and groom, in everyday clothes? Why, the groom might have been going out for a day's hunting, so casually was he dressed. As I stood there, at a loss for words and sensing that I had somehow done a bad thing, the groom turned and stood, making me gasp. He was tall, well over 6 feet, and dazzlingly handsome, with hair of a rich brown. Small, sallow, and of middling appearance, I was none of those things, and I averted my eyes as if caught gazing into the sun. "Well now, who is this young lady?"
"Katherine, sir," I managed.
"Kate," the groom said, as I thrilled from my head to my toes. How did this man know that I loved to be called Kate, only mother insisted on the more dignified Katherine? He turned to my sister.
"I've changed my mind, I'm afraid. This will be my new bride."
"She's a trifle young for you," said my sister a little tensely. She was, I could not help but notice, several years older than the groom.
"Oh, maybe a bit," the man conceded.
He smiled.
"Some other lucky man will have little Kate, then. Lady Kate, can you keep a great secret?"
"You had better," my mother warned.
"I know Kate will," the man said reassuringly.
He looked down, a long way down, straight into my eyes.
"Kate, I am getting ready to marry your sister, but it is a great secret. No one can know until I announce it personally."
"Your family would not approve," I ventured as he was being so confiding.
"Indeed, no."
"That is a pity."
"But they will come to understand in time."
He cleared his throat and looked thoughtful for a moment, then appeared to make up his mind.
"But there are other reasons why there are difficulties just now. I suppose you have not seen our King Edward yet, Kate?"
"No."
"Have you heard much of him?"
I was delighted by his question, for it gave me the opportunity to demonstrate what a good Yorkist I was, a great necessity in our family, since it was not so terribly long ago that Papa and my brothers Anthony and Richard had fought for the House of Lancaster. Having gone over to what now all agreed heartily to be the right side, Papa had sternly informed us children that we should always speak well of the House of York. As with all of my father's advice, I had heeded it dutifully, but I seldom had the chance to put it into practice, for all of my brothers and sisters, being older and much wiser, were naturally much better Yorkists, and never made a mistake I could correct.
"No," I admitted, "but I hear he is very brave, and very handsome."
The second man laughed, a sound that made the chapel echo. He was well over a decade older than the groom and less handsome, though his ruddy face was a pleasant one.
"Ned, there's a fine courtier for you. Shall I?"
The younger man nodded, and the older man reached in a purse and drew out a fine gold chain, then handed it to me. Later, I was to learn that he always kept one or two on his person in case of emergencies.
"There's a reward for your loyalty, Lady Kate."
"Thank you," I said, vacantly, staring at the chain. It was lovely, and even to my inexpert eyes looked frightfully expensive. Was my sister marrying a highwayman? The younger man laughed at my expression.
"You see, Kate, I am the king, and I have come here to marry your sister."
There were any number of dignified and proper responses I could have made to this announcement. I, of course, made none of them. My mouth gaped open most unattractively, I fear.
"You?"
I asked.
"Her?"
"Me? Her?"
The king nodded. "She will make a lovely queen, don't you think?"
"Yes,"
I admitted feebly. Bessie was, indeed, lovely. Sometimes I thought that she and my brother Anthony had taken so much beauty for themselves that there was not enough left for the other 10 of us children, especially me.
"But you must keep this a secret, Kate, as I have said, you will promise."
"On my life."
"Good girl,"
the king said. He grinned. "Or I would be obliged to put you in my tower as a lesson, you know." My previous promise was empty compared to the one I made now.
"I swear and hope to die if I break my promise,"
I vowed, kneeling and making the sign of the cross for good measure. I might have gone further and prostrated myself had Bessie not interrupted. Time passes. "Ned, I know the child will not tell. Can we please resume the ceremony?" While my sister and the king are getting married, it seems a good time to explain what sort of family the king was marrying into. My mother, Jacquetta of Luxembourg, was the daughter of the Count of St. Pol and the second wife of John, Duke of Bedford, brother to Henry V. My mother was but 17 at the time of their marriage. The Duke was in his 40s. They had been married only 2 years when the king fell ill and died, leaving Mama free to contract her scandalous marriage to my father, the son of the Duke's chamberlain. Mama could, and did, when roused, trace her ancestry to Charlemagne, but my father, Sir Richard Woodville, was a different matter altogether. He was no more than a knight when he and my mother wed, secretly and without the license of the king, the unfortunate 6th Henry, then a mere youth. The king could not let such a match pass without censure, and he promptly fined my parents £1,000. But he got over it soon enough, and so completely, that the marriage was the making of my father, a fact that he was candid enough to admit in the privacy of Grafton. In time, my father was made a baron and a knight of the garter by King Henry. He and Mama were among those appointed to bring Henry's bride, Margaret of Anjou, from France for the couple's marriage, and my mother was soon on the best of terms with Margaret, then a girl of 15. When poor Henry went mad, or took ill, as good Lancastrians said, and the Duke of York claimed the crown, Papa fought for Henry and for Margaret on the side of the House of Lancaster. Then, in 1461, there was the dreadful Battle of Towton. My father and my oldest brother Anthony were on the Queen's side. By this time, poor Henry was in such a state that no one thought of him as the person they were fighting for, and the Queen lost the battle horribly on a blindingly snowy day. The Woodville men were captured, and the Queen, the King, and their young son fled to Scotland. All seemed lost for the House of Lancaster, so when Father and Anthony were given the chance to make their peace with our new young King, the 4th Edward, they took it gladly. So faithfully did my father discharge his new allegiance that within 2 years he became a member of the King's Council. It was not all war and advancement with my parents since their marriage, however. There was the matter of begetting children, and that, my parents often said fondly, was a pursuit in which God had richly blessed them. Some died quite young, to everyone's sorrow, but by September of 1464 there were 12 of us living, 7 girls and 5 boys, Anthony at 7 and 20 being the oldest, and me at 6 being the youngest. I knew my parents worried about how they were going to provide for all of us when we grew older. My father's wealth came chiefly from my mother's dower lands, and because of England's reversals in France, Mother no longer enjoyed the revenues from her estates there. We were by no means poor, but she had to manage our household carefully. Yet, as shabby as some of our everyday furnishings were, our house was full of beautiful objects from my mother's days as the wife of a king's son. Sparkling gold cups, lushly illuminated manuscripts, my mother's coronet. They were too steeped in family history to be sold, but they hardly fit in with our modest existence at Grafton either. Still, my parents had managed to make matches for 3 of us, Bessie with Sir John Grey, Anthony with Elizabeth, Lady Scales, and Jacquetta with Lord Strange. They were good marriages, all agreed, and at 6 I was not much worried about whether a similarly suitable husband would be found for me when my time came. There were, after all, many sisters to get through before I became anyone's concern. Poor Bessie, though, had not been married for long when her husband, just barely knighted, poor man, was killed in the second battle at St. Albans in 1461, leaving her with 2 boys, Thomas and Richard. Bessie's husband, though of good family, had not been rich, and my sister was left with a small income and a fear that her husband's family would take what was due to her sons. She came back to us at Grafton, and with us she had been living for the past 3 years. Lovely as my sister was, no one had offered for her since. I suppose in those uncertain days more than just beauty and virtue were needed to attract a man. Until the king came along. When the ceremony ended, there were none of the usual festivities. The priest went to my sister's chamber. Being widowed, Bessie had been given one to herself when she came back to Grafton, and blessed the bed, practically mumbling so as not to wake the rest of the household. Then we all left, leaving the king and Bessie to consummate their marriage, the king's friend to go for a ride,
a very long ride. Eh, Ned?
I'd heard him hiss to the king, and my mother and I, though I do not think she was anticipating my assistance, to figure out how to keep the secret from spreading through the household. Some contrivance was certainly necessary, as the king was going to have to emerge from my sister's chamber sooner or later, and at 6 feet tall and with his dazzling looks, he did not exactly blend into his surroundings. I was full of helpful suggestions, dressing up the king in father's clothes, dressing up the king in mother's clothes, dressing him up in a monk's habit, having him use a rope ladder to crawl out the window, drugging the entire household with a sleeping potion. But, in the end, my mother settled for confiding in the most trustworthy of the servants, and the eldest of my brothers and sisters, who found various ways to occupy the uninitiated outside the house. This solution rather disgusted me, for I was certain I could have obtained a monk's habit if someone had just given me the chance. With this problem solved, though not as ingeniously as I would have preferred, the newlyweds tarried in my sister's chamber for several hours while the rest of us went around the daily business of the manor, keeping as well away from the bridal chamber as we could. I had to pass it a couple of times, I couldn't help it truly, and found that the sounds within were pretty much of the sort that emanated from my parents' bedchamber on occasion, with the exception of a few feminine giggles. I wondered what the king was doing to provoke this reaction from my rather serious sister. By noon, the king and his companion, William, Lord Hastings, I later learned, had ridden off, the king having first kissed Bessie very tenderly in the privacy of my mother's chamber, where he took his leave of us. My sister went back to her bedchamber to do whatever a commoner who had just secretly married a king did to pass the time, and I went outside, where I proposed to my nephews, who were nearer my own age than most of my brothers and sisters, that we play a game of getting married. They found the idea exceedingly dull and girl-like, and said so in no uncertain terms, so we played Buck Hyde instead, with I the hunter and they the bucks. It took me a while to find them, but I always succeeded. One of the advantages of having so many older brothers and sisters was that there was always someone I could find to give me whatever help I needed. If I was puzzled over my lesson, I went to Anthony if he was at Grafton or, most often, Lionel. If I needed to get through some difficult embroidery, I went to Mary. If I needed someone to get me out of trouble with Mama, I went to John. If I wanted a frog to put down someone's back, usually Jones, I went to Edward. If I wanted more information, though, I went to Anne, who more than the rest of us had the confidence of my sister. So, that night, after everyone had retired, I climbed out of the bed I shared with Joan and climbed into the bed that Anne had all to herself. "Kate, it's late." "Please, when else can I ask you?" I didn't even need to tell her what I sought. She knew. "Oh, all right." Anne sighed, purely for show. She loved being a fount of information. Meanwhile, several other heads poked out from behind bed curtains, for just as I relied upon Anne for information, my sisters had come to rely on me to ask the questions that they were too discreet to ask. "I suppose all of you know by now that Bessie got married today." Everyone nodded, to my disapproval, for this meant that someone had told the secret. I certainly had not. "But do you know who the groom is?" Joan and Margaret shook their heads. "Well, you'll think that this is madness when I say it, but it's not. Bessie has married the king." Joan and Margaret stared. "Are you joking?" Joan asked. "She is not." I tossed my head. "I was at the wedding." "What was a chit like you doing there?" That was Margaret. "Keeping my eyes and ears open," I said grandly. Then I realized that I was upstaging poor Anne, whose pretty face had turned almost sour. "But I don't know how they met or anything like that. I just know that they married today, and it is a great secret until the king says it can be told. So, how did it come about?" Anne relaxed, relieved that I was not attempting to usurp her. "Well, you know that poor Bessie had had problems with the Greys about her lands?" I nodded, for even I knew about this. It was a topic on which my sister, naturally enough, expounded a great deal. "Papa, of course, would have done what he could to aid her, being on the King's Council, but the Greys are so very well connected, what with their ties to the King's family, and we are not so very well connected. So she decided to go to Lord Hastings, the king's great friend, for help. He has land not far from here, you know." "I met him this morning," I broke in grandly. "A charming man. Ooh, pardon me." "Not far from here at all," Anne continued, a note of warning in her voice. "Anyway, he and Bessie agreed that one of her boys would marry one of Lord Hastings's daughters, although he doesn't have any yet. They were to share in the rents and profits of what could be recovered for the boys. That way, Bessie knew Hastings would help her to get what was due to her and to her sons. Wasn't that clever of Bessie?" We nodded approvingly. "So it might have ended there, but..." She looked at me and hesitated. "Lord Hastings is, a man with an eye for a pretty woman, they say, and so is the king. He, sometimes, introduces the king to women he thinks he might like. And Hastings thought that the king might like Bessie. So, when the king and Hastings went to Stony Stratford on business, he told Bessie that the king wanted to see her about the arrangement. And she came to him.
And the king liked her, I surmised. Very much, but you see, the king likes a great many women. Anyway, he spoke with Bessie a very long time, and then he found an excuse to call her back to him the next day, and then he asked Bessie to be his mistress. The raptness of her audience overcame Anne's discretion, fortunately for me, for I could not have borne it had she fallen silent. You know, to lie with him but not to be his wife. He told her that if she did, she could have anything she wanted for herself and for her family, and that she would be kept in the best of comfort. I nodded sagely, though in truth I was shocked. I had seen some wicked women once at a fair, with tight bright gowns and brighter cheeks and hair, and had been hustled past them by my brother John. Surely that was not what the king had had in mind for Bessie. But Bessie refused. She said that she had her boys' good names to protect, and her own honour, along with that of Papa and Mamma, and that she would be no man's mistress, not even if the man was her king. So the king shrugged and dismissed her rather coldly. This was way back in April. Then, just a few weeks ago, Hastings asked the king for our nephew Tom's wardship and marriage as part of the agreement he'd made with Bessie. The king agreed and signed the document. Then, just 3 days ago, Bessie got a note from the king asking to see her alone. After he tried to seduce her? Asked Mary. I made a mental note to find out what seduce meant. Maybe Lionel could tell me. Well, she felt she had to. It might affect Tom's lands after all, and he wasn't asking for a meeting by night, so she felt safe. So she went and waited by that old oak tree that people meet at around here, and then he came galloping up and told her that he had been thinking about her all summer and that he couldn't bear it any longer. And then he told her that a queen should be virtuous and a queen should be beautiful and that she was both, so why should she not be his queen? His advisers wouldn't like it, but they would have to accept the idea or they could go hang. I believe they must have kissed and so forth quite a long time. Anne blushed, and then he gave her his ring as a token of his fidelity and told her to have Mamma find a priest and that they would marry the next morning, that is, today. And so they did. That is the most splendid romantic thing I have ever heard in my life, I murmured. I could hardly wait until the next morning to reenact the scene with my dolls, though I was still somewhat unclear about the mistress and the seducing part. Still, I could improvise quite well, and I certainly understood the kissing part. I wonder when the king will announce it, said Mary. Anne shrugged. It will probably be a while. The kingmaker won't like it. The kingmaker? I asked. I thought God made kings, just like the rest of us. Margaret rolled her eyes. The next frog Edward procured would be for her. Anne laughed. The kingmaker is Richard Neville, the Earl of Warwick. He is immensely rich and very popular among the people, and it was with his support that King Edward gained the throne after his father, the Duke of York, was killed at Wakefield. Were it not for the kingmaker, Henry might still be on the throne. So why would he not like the king marrying Bessie? Because he would prefer him to marry another king's daughter, or at least a member of another king's family. Such marriages can be useful at times of war. Bessie can be of no good that way, being English. And there is the matter of a dowry as well. Kings like rich brides, and sometimes need them quite badly. But she is virtuous and beautiful, I said, deciding that no kingmaker would be welcome among my dolls tomorrow. Edward and Bessie could do quite nicely all by themselves. That will have to be enough, because she certainly won't bring a dowry with her, not fit for a king anyway, Anne laughed. I wonder what that will mean for us once it is announced, said Margaret. We will be the Queen's sisters after all. Shall we go to court? Why not? Said Mary. Court, I murmured. How wonderful that would be. Then I yawned immensely and Anne shook her head. Before you think of going to court, Missy, you'd best think of going to bed.
As the days passed, the Queen of England continued her usual life at Grafton with the rest of us, tending her two sons, embroidering, even helping with the work of the household when necessary. When no servants were present, for not all had been let in on the secret, I rather enjoyed calling my sister Your Grace, when possible. Will Your Grace come to dinner now? Has Your Grace seen that shirt I was mending for Father? But the charm of that began to wear thin, especially for Bessie, who more than once told me to stop my Your Gracing and make myself scarce. She said it, though, in a suitably regal tone. I might have wondered if the wedding had been a dream, but it was not that the king had forgotten about his bride. Every couple of days, a nondescript messenger on a nondescript horse would appear at Grafton with a royal letter for Bessie and usually a small gift, some trimmings, a purse, a top for the boys. Sometimes there were pretty presents for the rest of us as well. I still have a little brooch from that period. Papa, meanwhile, had been visiting one of our other manors on business, unaware that he had acquired the king as a son-in-law. When he arrived home, Mama and Bessie quickly pulled him aside for a conference, from which he emerged looking like a man who had been struck by lightning. For the rest of his stay, he looked pleased and proud, but also a little dazed. That first evening home, he asked, "Did I ever tell you younger children what happened at Sandwich?" We were all sitting in the solar, one of the improvements my parents had made to Grafton while they still had the income from their French lands and when there were not quite so many of us children. Most of us shook our heads. "Well, Anthony and I were fighting for Lancaster at the time, back in 1460. My father looked vaguely apologetic before continuing. "We were planning to set sail for Guin, which the Duke of Somerset had taken to help him take Calais. Instead, the Yorkists took your mother and Anthony and me by surprise in our beds, no less. So, we were captured and hauled off to Calais. We had good weather, but it was about the longest trip I've ever made in my life, let me tell you, for I was a prisoner of York. When we arrived there, the Earl of Warwick and the Earl of March, that is, our present king, rated us mercilessly. They said that I was a low-born knave's son who had been made by marriage, and that Anthony as my son was no better." "I could have scratched their eyes out," Mama interrupted, "such impudence, and I in my oldest night shift." "I believe you would have scratched their eyes out, my dear, if they hadn't taken the precaution of shackling you. Anyway, they carried on like that for hours, or at least it felt like it. And as we were at sword point and badly outnumbered, there was nothing we could do but bear it with dignity. When the king appointed me to his council, he said nothing of the incident, and neither did I. Better just let some things be, I've always said." He smiled wryly. "And now the man is my son-in-law. I am sorely tempted when I attend his council at Reading to remind him of our conversation."
"Do you think he'll announce it at Reading?" Anne asked.
"He left a letter assuring me that Bessie would receive all honours due her, but did not give specifics. Who knows? Do you, Bessie?"
Bessie held out her palms and shrugged. "He tells me he will announce it when the time is right."
"Whenever that is," muttered Margaret. "It is an awkward situation for the king, my dears. When has such a thing happened before in England? A king marrying in secret and making his bride his queen." "Well," said my brother John cheerfully, "someone had to be the first." My sisters and I, including the Queen, were sewing one morning in late September when we heard the sound of approaching horses. Many horses, I realized, just as Bessie, with a sharp intake of breath, walked to the window.
"It is true," she breathed.
She grabbed Anne, her usual confidante.
"The king has told his council. The secret's out."
We all crowded to the window, where I saw that the days of our nondescript single messenger had ended. A score of men were riding up on the finest horses to be seen in England, and no one who saw them could be in any doubt as to from whom they came, for the man in front bore what even I recognised as the king's standard, the Lion of England and the Lily of France. A gaggle of villagers had attached themselves to the contingent and trailed at a respectful distance behind them, doubtlessly hoping to pick up some gossip.
Follow me.
We lined up behind Bessie obediently and filed into the hall, where the royal entourage had just arrived. My sister had barely cleared the doorway when the king's men went down upon their knees.
Rise, she ventured after a moment or two. With growing confidence, she added, what news do you bring?
Your Grace, I bring word from the king. His Grace has informed his council at Reading of his marriage. He wishes Your Grace to proceed to Reading so that Your Grace might be introduced to the council and to others of importance.
Even in the midst of these Your Graces, Bessie looked down at her dress, which was far from new, with such a look of horror that the man came close to smiling as he guessed my sister's thoughts.
The king wishes to assure you that all necessary items of apparel are being prepared against Your Grace's arrival.
I longed to ask, can the rest of us come? But hardly dared.
My eyes, however, must have spoken for me, because the man added,
His Grace will be pleased to see the Queen's family at Reading also, but he asks that they return to Grafton afterward while lodgings are being prepared for them.
Where? Asked the Queen.
It is not certain, Your Grace. The King intends to stay at Windsor after he leaves Reading, but he may choose quarters at Greenwich or Sheen for the family of Your Grace. For now.
For now? My mother asked.
It is the King's intention that your daughters be wedded suitably, and soon, to men worthy of a Queen's sister. Their residence at court may thus be only temporary.
I grabbed at one of my sister's hands. Any sister would do, to keep upon my feet. Windsor, spoken as we might say Grafton, wedded suitably. I had imagined this scene often enough, enacted some reasonable facsimile thereof with my dolls, but now that it was coming true, it was beyond belief. Nothing, I realized, would ever be the same for the Woodville family now. Nothing.
3. September 1464 to May 1465. The kingmaker, it appeared, had given much thought to finding a suitable bride for the young king. It had been with the greatest satisfaction that he informed the king's council, meeting at Reading Abbey, that he was all set to travel abroad to negotiate for the hand of the French king's sister-in-law, Bona of Savoy, a most beauteous lady, the kingmaker noted, with an appreciative smack of his lips. The Earl of Warwick was getting ready to elaborate, whether upon the proposed terms or upon the lady's charms no one shall ever know, when the king held up his hand for silence.
"I fear that there is an obstacle of my own making to this proposed match," he said quietly. "You have had my interests well at heart, and I commend you for it and shall remember it, but no marriage can take place for the best reason in the world. The truth is, my lords, I am already married."
He paused, but no one even attempted to speak. "To an Englishwoman, to a beautiful, seemly Englishwoman who will fulfil her role admirably, to the former Lady Elizabeth Grey, the daughter of Lord Rivers here." According to my father, my informant, the kingmaker's expression might have scared the dead out of their tombs. The king rose and beamed.
"I suspect, my lords, you may wish to discuss this matter amongst yourselves more freely. I shall take myself off so that you can do so, and I shall send for my queen, so that she may be received by you in the proper manner. Come, Lord Rivers, with me."
My father obeyed, but he had barely cleared the room before the kingmaker let forth a series of expletives in both English and French. Even if I could bring myself to reproduce his words here, it would be impossible, for my father felt that they were far too vivid and descriptive to be shared with the family. There was more silence, either in awe of the Earl's hitherto unknown verbal dexterity, or in fear that the king would return, until Lord Hastings said mildly,
"Now, now, my lord. I've seen her, and I can tell you that she's a lovely woman, and with two sons, she's fertile to boot.
Which one is the kingmaker? I hissed to John as we rode toward Reading Abbey, me riding pillion behind John. For most of the trip to Reading I'd been behind one of the king's men, but for the last stretch of the journey I'd begged to ride behind John, who as ever had cheerfully obliged.
Never seen him, you know, but I'd lay odds on the brown-haired man standing next to the king. He looks disgusted enough, said John.
As subtly as I could, which was probably not very subtly at all, I gazed at Warwick, the kingmaker, if indeed that was he, and felt a twinge of disappointment. Aside from his robes, which were obviously of great cost, he was an ordinary-looking man, neither tall nor short, handsome nor plain. Even his hair was the most unassuming type of brown. It did not help, of course, that he was standing next to my new brother-in-law, who was every bit as fine as I remembered. We rode toward the rear of the Queen's party, whose imminent arrival had evidently prompted the King and several other men to stand at the Abbey entrance, waiting. As the rest of us drew rein, the King stepped forward and headed straight toward my sister's horse. As Warwick and a boy in his teens watched, both looking slightly greenish, Edward greeted my sister not as a king meeting his queen, but as a young man of 22 who had been eagerly awaiting his love. Not allowing a page to do the job, he assisted Bessie from her horse, embraced her, and kissed her soundly and quite at length for their being in a public place.
"Welcome to Reading, my dear," he said, stepping back.
For a moment I thought he was going to draw Bessie into another extended kiss, but he mastered himself and waved a hand that included all of the family.
"And welcome all."
Warwick's eyes moved from Woodville to Woodville, quite evidently counting us and arriving at a figure he thought was too high. It was the boy, however, who said,
"Quite a sizable family, Ned." "As a matter of fact, George, there are some missing, I believe," said the King genially. He glanced around. "Who's not here?"
As this seemed to be a question anyone was free to answer, the impulse to be the one to provide this information to the King was irresistible to me.
"My sister Jacquetta," I called out, "and my brother Anthony. We hope they will be here soon, though."
The King's smile grew even broader, and he walked to where I still sat my horse behind John. As effortlessly as if he were lifting a kitten, he swept me out of my seat, then swung me round as I squealed in delight.
"This is my wife's chief rival for my affections," he said solemnly, after kissing me on the cheek and placing me on the ground before Warwick and George. "I am very glad to see you here, Kate."
George tried not to glare at me as I beamed toothily up at them. The kingmaker managed a fine new sister-in-law indeed. He smiled. It looked like a painful process. It was a couple of days later, on Michaelmas, that the King's Council and some sundry other men of importance gathered into Reading Abbey and awaited the formal presentation of my sister as England's Queen. My mother and my second oldest sister, Jacquetta, Lady Strange, were to carry my sister's train, but the rest of us Woodvilles stood in a large knot in the transept with the others. The kingmaker and the king's brother, George, were to lead my sister into the abbey. By now I had learned that the king had a number of brothers and sisters, but several had died very young. The next oldest boy after Edward, Edmund, had died aged 17 with the Duke of York at the Battle of Wakefield. Remaining to the king were three sisters, Anne, Duchess of Exeter, Elizabeth, Duchess of Suffolk, and the Lady Margaret, who had yet to be married, and two brothers, George, Duke of Clarence, and Richard, Duke of Gloucester. George, the only one of them present at Reading, was not quite 15 at the time. Though his hair was lighter, he otherwise greatly resembled the king. He was tall and nicely built, having an exceptionally handsome face without the spottiness that marred so many faces of youths his age.
yet I did not find his looks as nearly as appealing as the king's, though I could not quite understand why. Still, he looked more agreeable than he had the day of our arrival, perhaps because he was aware of the fine figure he cut, as silence was ordered, and he and Warwick processed into the abbey, my sister between them. I gasped as John lifted me onto his shoulders to get a better look. Lovely enough in everyday clothes, Bessie was stunning in the scarlet and gold robes, trimmed with ermine, that the king's tailor had hastened to make for her. The king, I supposed, must have given her the jewels that sparkled as she moved, for they were certainly not anything from my mother's collection, which I liked to sort through on rainy days. Were it not for the fact that her hair was concealed by her headdress instead of being unbound, she might as well have been going to her coronation. She might have been born to be a queen, indeed, for she walked with her two escorts and her train-bearers as though she were perfectly accustomed to such pomp. Bessie walked to the altar where the king stood. He stepped forward and took her hand as my mother and my sister gracefully swiveled backward with her train, which fortunately for them was a relatively short one.
"I give you your most gracious lady, my wife and consort, your Queen Elizabeth."
After that, any business of the council was strictly anticlimactic. Soon its members dispersed to their homes, as did we Woodvilles. The king and queen stayed at Reading for several weeks, with only a small company of servants. I knew there were hopes, in my family at least, and presumably on the king's part, that my sister would emerge from this quiet time with an heir to the throne in her belly. Before the council departed from Reading, however, the king, my father, and the Earl of Arundel had a conference. When it ended, my sister Margaret was betrothed to the Earl's 14-year-old Earl, Thomas FitzAlan. We had barely settled ourselves at Grafton before it was time to escort Margaret to Arundel Castle in Sussex, where she was to live with the Earl's family until she and Thomas were a little older and were considered ready to consummate their marriage. Perched up high above its surroundings and even more magnificent inside than it appeared from the outside, the castle was the grandest place in which any of us girls had been to date, and, as the Earl and his family were most hospitable, I was at liberty to wander around it undisturbed. I lost no time in climbing the winding stairs to the castle's highest turret, where I gazed down at the River Arun and the town below, imagining myself in the glorious days of the third King Edward, with some knight in shining armour racing across the terrain to save me. From what he was supposed to be saving me was a matter on which I was vague, not to mention historically somewhat confused. When we left Margaret in her new home and returned to Grafton, it seemed unbearably small, even with fewer of us living there now. I did not have too long to suffer, though, for, in December, we were on the move again, this time to Eltham Palace. It would not only be my first time at a royal palace, it would be the first time I met the king's family other than Clarence, and I did not think he had boded all that well. Our days at Eltham were formal, with the elaborate lengthy meals that I was used to, on a considerably smaller scale, from Grafton. In the evening, however, only the immediate family gathered in the king's chamber, some to play chess or other games, some to dice, some to dance, and some just to chatter. And it was then that I began to get a sense of who my new relations were. Cecily, the king's mother, was pointedly absent from the gathering. I heard later that she had carried on dreadfully about her son's marriage to a commoner, and John swore that steam had been seen to rise from her hennin when she heard the news, but the king's brothers and youngest sister, Margaret, all had come for the festivities from Greenwich, where they spent most of their time. George, of course, I had met. Margaret was 18, old, I thought, to still be unmarried, especially since she was quite seemly in appearance, though very tall for a woman. If she had any misgivings about her brother's marriage, she kept them to herself, and spoke quite amicably to the Queen and the rest of us. Encouraged by her approachability, I always claimed the closest seat to her on informal occasions when protocol did not forbid it. If she got tired of me doing this, she had the goodness never to say so. Richard, Duke of Gloucester, 12 years old, was the youngest of the royal family. Unlike the King, George and Margaret, he was of middling height, with just a fortunate inch or so saving him from being called short. He was darker than they were too, though far from ill-favoured. As he was much quieter than his brother or George, though not at all melancholy, I paid little mind to him. Edward's sister Elizabeth, the Duchess of Suffolk, and her husband the Duke, John de la Pole, did not make much of an impression on my young mind either, though my mother had been godmother to Elizabeth 20 years before when she was born in Rouen. They were a quiet couple. My brother Lionel told me that the Duke of Suffolk was the great-grandson of the poet Geoffrey Chaucer, which impressed Lionel a great deal. I, however, stayed at a distance, lest the poor Duke, who in all fairness did not appear the least bit inclined to do so, fall into reciting verse to me. By far the most interesting of the King's family, aside of course from the King himself, was his older sister Anne, Duchess of Exeter. She had arrived at Eltham after Margaret, George, and Richard. Finding it strange that a duchess should be without a duke, I sidled up to the Lady Margaret at the earliest opportunity. "Where is the Duke, my lady? The Duke of Exeter?" "Oh, dear," said Margaret, "you mustn't mention that Duke, you know." "Why, is he dead?" "Worse, a Lancastrian." Margaret looked around to see if she could speak in safety, and finding that she could, continued, "Her husband is Henry Holland. My late father arranged their marriage when they were quite young, but they never suited, although they have a girl, another Anne, who is to marry Warwick's nephew." "The kingmaker, that Warwick?" Margaret smiled. "Yes, that Warwick. Anyway, the Duke of Exeter was never loyal to my father, even though he was his son-in-law. He fought against him time after time, and Anne had no influence over him. He could have made his peace after Toton, as did all others with sense," she glanced in my father's direction, "but he refused, and now he is in France with that virago Margaret of Anjou, where we all hope they stay and rot. Of course it must be hard for her, the Duchess of Exeter," I hastened to add, as Margaret's eyebrows shot up and she stiffened. I wondered if she had been named for the virago in more congenial times. Margaret, evidently assured that I did not have latent Lancastrian tendencies, relaxed again. "Well, my brother has treated her well. She was granted her husband's forfeited estates, so she lives quite comfortably. And she has custody of the little Duke of Buckingham, who is very wealthy. I wonder that he is not here with her, in fact. Hush, now, here she comes." I hardly needed the warning, as the Duchess of Exeter was a large lady, though of the sort who carried her avoirdupois grandly, and her entry into a room could not be readily missed. I moved to let the sisters sit side by side, but Margaret kindly steered me to a nearby stool. "We are all sisters now. Stay." As I settled down, respectfully silent but quite alert, she asked Anne, "So, where are your charges?" "They stayed behind. Humphrey is ailing." "Poor Humphrey is always ailing. I am surprised, though, you chose not to bring Harry by himself. There has been talk, you know." "I know, but Humphrey never does well without Harry, and I shall not have it on my conscience that I caused the boy to sicken worse. And Harry wouldn't have gone with Humphrey ill, anyway. He's very protective of him." "It's sweet to see, but quite sad, too. That boy hasn't long for the world, even though I have the best physicians attending him. There's plenty of time for this other business, after all. Harry's but 9. So, has a girl been chosen, by the by? There seem to be several likely choices." "I cannot say, but I think the answer is close at hand." "Ah. So, sister, how goes it with your marriage negotiations?" "But my favourite new relation was the Duchess of Norfolk, who was the King's aunt, being his mother's older sister. She was 64 and immensely rich, and Margaret told me in private after she came to know me a little better that her heirs had a running wager over whether she would ever die. More as an accessory than out of need, she used a cane, finely carved and richly bejewelled, and in speaking she often used it to emphasise her points, sometimes even poking the listener when she wanted to be particularly emphatic. By this I do not mean that she was a harridan. Her pokes were usually of the friendliest sort. I should know, as she took somewhat of a fancy to me, "My fellow Katherine," and "a bright-eyed creature," she called me, and I was often called upon to help her thread her needle or some similar task suited for the young and sharp-eyed. John, my third oldest brother, though quite useless for such ladies' tasks, also got quite a few pokes with the cane that Christmas, being, like the Duchess, quite fond of chess. Just after a few days at Eltham Palace, it had become generally accepted that a small table in the corner was reserved for them alone, and I often heard the Duchess thumping her cane in satisfaction when she had made a good move, or in warning, when John was being too dilatory in making his. It was nearly Twelfth Night when the King came in and waved for silence, rather to my disappointment, for I had been practising some dance steps with my brother Richard, who, despite being the quietest male in the family, was the best dancer. Thanks to his skill, I was practically floating. As we came to a halt, Edward said, "I am pleased to say that there will be another wedding in the family, within a couple of weeks, as a matter of fact." We unmarried Woodville girls looked back and forth at each other. We shared the same suite of chambers at Eltham. Had one of us been keeping a secret from the others? It was something we frowned upon. "Not I, brother, I hope," asked Margaret. There was always some scheme afoot to marry her to someone, I knew. I suspected that she was in no hurry to leave England. "No, my dear, don't you think I'd have the courtesy to tell you first? No. Our happy couple is my dear aunt, the Duchess of Norfolk, and young John here." He gestured over toward the chess table where my brother and the Duchess had duly lifted their attention from the game. "Will you join me in congratulating them?" "Have you lost your senses?" said George. "No, have you lost yours, speaking to your king like that?" "Brother, it is diabolical. A man of how old? 20? And a lady in her 60s? "George, it is obscene." He looked around for the youngest female in the room, who, much to my dismay, turned out to be me, and pointed, "Why not put this girl in bed with a man of 70 while you're at it?" "How dare you speak of my young sister in bed with anyone, you blackguard?" demanded John. "How dare you address me so when you are not even a knight?" "That will soon be remedied, I hear," said John. "In the meantime, how are my marital affairs any of your concern? I am not in your wardship." "No, because a ward must have an income, and you've none. A fine sort to marry a duchess. And my own aunt, Ned, don't you see the canker you've set loose? It's not bad enough that you marry a nobody just because she wouldn't spread her leg." The king lunged at George, and I truly think he might have murdered him then and there were it not for what happened next. The Duchess of Norfolk stepped between the brothers and rapped her cane against the floor with a mighty thud. Then she prodded George with it. "Silence, you fool!" George stepped back, breathing hard. So did the king. As my heirs know to their chagrin, I am in full possession of my faculties. I am marrying this young man under duress from no one and at no one's instigation except for his and mine, said the Duchess. Our motives are simple. I wish for congenial companionship in my old age, and he wishes for a larger income. We have become friends over these past days, and we understand each other perfectly. Our marriage will provide us both with what we desire, which in neither case has anything to do with the bedchamber. So, nephew George, you may rest your mind easy on that account. In fact, I suggest you retire and rest your body as well before you say something else you will come to regret. George muttered something that sounded vaguely apologetic and left the chamber. My sister's lip was trembling. I had seen it do so from anger as well as from hurt, and I wondered which emotion was uppermost. The king put a hand on her shoulder.
"George can be a fool sometimes, as you've seen," he said quietly. "I will speak to him further about his folly tomorrow. I suggest we retire for the evening, my dear."
He waved breezily to the rest of us.
"But the rest of you are free to stay and make merry."
None of us, however, felt like doing so.
"Why, John, why would you put us to shame?"
"Shame in marrying a rich widow, sister? I am not exactly the first man to conceive such an idea, my dear."
The king was transacting some business, leaving the queen with her ladies, mamma, and some of her sisters to do needlework together. Along with the rest of the ladies, save for mamma, I moved off at a distance and made a great show of playing with my sister's dog by the hearth, hoping that my presence would not be remembered, as it too often was when conversations turned interesting.
"A rich widow 40 years older than you."
"Not to be ungallant, but it's 45, actually."
"What will people say? It would not be so bad if there were a possibility of children, but..."
"You heard the lady last night. It suits us both, and by people, I suppose you mean the Earl of Warwick, not just the king's fool brother George."
"John, do bear in mind that the Earl is a powerful man and that George is next in line to the throne. He cannot be dismissed so easily, not until I bear a son."
"Something you have had no difficulty doing in the past, and something the king has effected with others in the past too, if rumour informs me correctly. Ah, sister, don't look so distressed. You cannot believe that the king came to your bed a virgin."
I concentrated hard on making myself invisible and evidently succeeded.
"John, I am in no mood for your jests today. I have found out but recently..."
My sister bit her lip and fixed her eyes on her embroidery.
"Found out what, Bessie?"
"Mamma said, the king has a mistress, it appears."
"The king has several, of varying degrees and complexion," John said bluntly. "Always has, always will. Bessie, your husband is not the sort of man who can be faithful to a single woman. Some men simply aren't, you know. Face that and treat it as a failing about which you can do nothing and you will be far happier. They're not his queen. You are."
"That is what Mamma tells me, but..."
"But what, sweetheart?"
"I am not with child yet again. I have had evidence of it just this morning."
"Pshaw! You and the king have been together constantly only since late September. There's plenty of time. Now, let me tell you the conditions that the Duchess has set upon my marriage with her, and that will make you smile. I am not to incur huge gaming debts. A gentlemanly amount is fine, but not huge ones. I am to spend time at my wife's household regularly, except in times of war, when I can be excused. My dogs are to stay out of her chamber. My harlots, the Duchess flatters me by assuming I have harlots, though I don't, are to stay far away from any property that she owns, and I am not to wear my doublets too short, for it is a fashion of which she mightily disapproves, and that she informs me makes any man appear to have a large arse."
"Did she really say arse?"
The Queen and my mother looked stricken.
"Catherine, do go work on your music, immediately." "Yes, Your Grace."
"Kate?"
"Yes, John?"
"She did say arse. Now run along."
The Duchess of Norfolk and John were married not long after that in the King's Chapel at Westminster Palace. The Duchess's heirs stayed far away from the ceremony, as did her nephews, the Kingmaker and George, but those of us who attended enjoyed ourselves thoroughly, and John's doublet was not at all too short. With this excitement over, the court was busy planning for my sister's coronation in May, while we unmarried Woodvilles settled into our living quarters at Greenwich, which the King had granted to my sister along with Sheen. Overlooking the Thames and a short barge ride to Westminster or Sheen, it well deserved its nickname of Placentia, House of Pleasure. I had been resident at Greenwich Palace, which is precisely how I liked to say it in those days, for some time when, Around Easter, the Duchess of Exeter was announced. She swept into the Queen's chamber, followed by two boys who almost seemed lost behind her rustling, trailing skirts. The boys knelt to the Queen, who quickly bade them to rise, after which I had the leisure to study them. I guessed the older to be about 9, the younger about 7. With their curling, dark, shoulder-length hair, large brown eyes, and finely etched facial features, it was obvious that they were brothers, but though neither boy could be called robust-looking, it was painfully apparent that the younger boy was of delicate, if not outright sickly, health. His gentle face was too pale and had a pinched expression, and he seemed to need the help of the older boy to rise.
"Your Grace, may I present the Duke of Buckingham, Henry Stafford?" the Duchess of Exeter said, "and Lord Humphrey Stafford, his brother."
My sister smiled. "Welcome, boys, to your new home. I believe you shall like it well here."
"New home?"
The boys, however, did not look surprised.
"Someone shall show you to your chambers," the Queen continued. Her eyes travelled to me, "and then my sister, Lady Catherine, will show you around the grounds if you like."
"Not Humphrey, Your Grace, if you please," said the Duke of Buckingham quickly. "He's tired from the barge and needs to rest."
"Tired from the barge?" I wondered in the arrogance of good health.
"Harry, speak only when you are bidden," warned the Duchess of Exeter.
"But Humphrey's tired," said the small Duke in a firm voice.
There was something fierce in his face, which changed abruptly when he looked down at his brother.
"Aren't you, Humphrey?"
"A bit," admitted Humphrey.
"Then he must be allowed to rest."
The Duchess of Exeter opened her mouth, probably to give the Duke of Buckingham another talking to, but my sister said,
"I quite understand, my dear. Go to your chamber and rest as long as you need, both of you. There will be plenty of time to get used to your new surroundings."
"I told them I didn't need to have you show me around, but they said I should go anyway," said Harry a while later. "You see, I've been here before, with the Duchess of Exeter. I probably know this place better than you do, actually."
As the youngest of 12 children, I was well used to being told that other people knew things better than I did, so I merely shrugged and said, "Probably." Harry Stafford looked somewhat perturbed by my lack of opposition.
"But I suppose your sister wouldn't know that."
"My sister, the Queen," I reminded him softly.
"Well, anyway, I've been to most of the royal palaces. I'm a ward of the King, you see, and I've been in the care of the Duchess of Exeter."
"I know. The Duchess mentioned it when she was at court for Christmas."
I felt that I had scored a point here, and being naturally magnanimous, I added,
"I suppose you are a ward because your father is dead."
I had begun to understand how these things worked. The boy nodded.
"My father and my grandfather, the first Duke. My father died a couple of years before grandfather was killed at Northampton."
"How was he killed?"
"Why, in battle, in 1460, of course. He was guarding King Henry's tent and some knaves killed him. He was outnumbered badly or he would have slain the cowards."
The Duke's eyes narrowed disdainfully, not at the knaves, but at my ignorance.
"Don't you know anything?"
"I can speak French."
"Well, so can I. Anyone can."
"But not like this."
Thanks to my mother, I spoke French as easily as English and with no trace of an English accent. I launched into some prayers in my mother's tongue at top speed, but not, I am afraid, with the proper reverence due to the words I was speaking, and saw to my satisfaction that I had left the boy far behind me, so fast and fluent was I.
"Well, that's not so much," he said when I finally stopped for air. "The French are our enemies after all." He frowned. "You sound too French, I think."
Youngest as I might be, I could be pushed only so far.
"I was born in England, for your information, and the King says I have a lovely speaking voice. Just you ask him. And what is it to you how I sound?"
"Because..."
I stomped off in high dudgeon before the Duke of Buckingham could finish his sentence.
"What do you know about the Duke of Buckingham?"
I asked Cecilia, my nurse, that evening as she braided my hair for the night.
Little Duke Harry? Oh, my!
Cecilia gave my half-formed braid an emphatic tug. When he's of age, he'll be the richest person in England other than royalty. At least, once the Dowager Duchess of Buckingham dies and he gets her dower lands. Of course, he's close enough to royalty himself. A descendant of Thomas Woodstock, the third King Edward's youngest son, and of his second oldest son, John of Gaunt, if you please, through Catherine Swinford. John and Catherine had the Beaufort babes when he was married to someone else, mind you, but then they tidied things up right well after he was widowed by marrying themselves. So the Duke has royal blood on both sides of the blanket. His Beaufort relations are Lancastrians through and through, and so were the young Duke's Stafford father and grandfather. I don't know if little Harry has an opinion on the matter.
Oh, I think he has an opinion on everything, I muttered.
Eh? The young Duke didn't make a good impression?
I thought he was very rude. How am I to know about Northampton with so many battles to keep straight?
I sulked for a moment or two.
Is his mother alive?
Yes, but as the Buckingham heir, young Harry was taken to live with his grandparents when his father died. Then the king bought his wardship from his grandmother, the Duchess of Buckingham, and he was put in the Duchess of Exeter's household to be raised, and now in the Queen's to be raised. It's a great deal of shunting around for a boy his age, but such is the lot of the rich.
Why'd they take the boys from the Duchess of Exeter's household and put them in my sister's?
My, you're full of questions, aren't you? Well, it's the only way to learn things, they say. Cecilia stepped back to admire her handiwork as she always did. Well, I've a notion, but as it's no more than that, I think I'd best keep it to myself for now.
Why?
Because that's my notion. The next day I was told that my sister had a visitor of some importance who particularly wished to see me. After some delay, during which more fuss had been made than usual about my clothing, I was sent to my sister's chamber. There sat a lady who, though somewhat younger, reminded me a bit in appearance of the Duchess of Norfolk. With her was my mother, newly arrived from Grafton, where she travelled to and from court from time to time.
"Hello, my dear," said Mamma, giving me a kiss after I dropped a curtsy to them all. "This is the Duchess of Buckingham. We have known each other a very long time since we were often at court together during the time of Margaret of Anjou. The Duchess of Buckingham is sister to the Duchess of York, the King's mother, and to the Duchess of Norfolk, John's wife." Momentarily overwhelmed by all of these duchesses, I merely nodded, then remembered that I had been told by the Duchess of Norfolk that her father, Ralph Neville, the Earl of Westmoreland, had sired nearly 24 children, including the kingmaker's late father, by his 2 wives. I wondered how he had kept their names all straight. Perhaps he couldn't, and had assigned one of his servants to this task exclusively.
"She's a little thing," said the Duchess of Buckingham. "Why, the title will be longer than the girl."
"But very healthy. Catherine has hardly had a sick day in her life."
"That's certainly to be desired. Tell me, child, I hear that you met my grandson Harry yesterday. Did you like him?"
I was still indignant about being called too French, but I could hardly tell this to Harry's grandmother, especially as I was puzzling over this exchange between her and Mamma.
"Yes, Your Grace," I said in a rather flat tone.
"Good. It has been arranged that you are to marry him. The wedding will take place just before the Queen's coronation, so you and I shall share a title, Duchess of Buckingham."
I rocked back on my heels. Since coming to court, I had learned a great deal about matters of precedence, and I knew that as Duchess of Buckingham I would be one of the greatest ladies of the land. Only a few women, such as the Queen and the King's sisters, would outrank me. Sakes alive! My own sisters, except for the Queen, would have to give way to me. I would wear a gold circlet on my head. Save for one of the King's brothers, I could not have made a grander match in all of England. And the young Duke was rich. How many castles and manors would he have to call his own when he came of age? I would have my own household, my own servants, my own ladies. In time, I would surely have my own children, set to continue this grand lineage down through the generations. I came out of my ducal ruminations to see that my mother was staring at me with amusement.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.